All right, so today I'm going to go over the blood clotting cascades and medications used to anticoagulate patients. This is all pretty much specific for surgery. So first off, there are some mechanisms to prevent clotting in the blood. The endothelial cells secrete nitric oxide and prostacyclin, and there is a heparin sulfate on the endothelial surface, which binds with antithrombin 3. The heparin sulfate potentiates the activity of antithrombin 3 over 1,000-fold, which helps prevent clotting. And remember that protamine is the reversal agent for heparin overdose. There's also a protein called thrombomodulin on the endothelial cells, which helps bind thrombin, which in turn activates protein C. And protein C and S will inhibit the coagulation factors 5 and 8, which we'll talk about later. Next, let's talk about the actual clotting cascade, what happens when you have vascular injury. There's five steps, roughly. The first would be vascular spasm, which is mediated by smooth muscle contraction. Second would be formation of a platelet plug. Next would be the coagulation cascade, which is the factors that we'll go over with the numbers attached to them. Four is repair of the injury using cytokines. And five is fibrinolysis, which is breakdown of the clot so that it doesn't propagate throughout your entire vascular system. So when you have an injury to a vessel wall, there's damage to the endothelial cells, and these release von Willebrand factor. Von Willebrand factor binds to platelets via the GP1B receptor. Once the platelets are activated, they start to signal other platelets. Some of the chemical signals they send out include serotonin, thromboxane A2, which is what aspirin, which is a COX inhibitor, works against to decrease thromboxane A2 signaling, and ADP through the ADP receptor. The ADP receptor blocking drugs include clopidogrel, which is Plavix, ticlopidine, which is Ticlid, ticagrelor, which is Brilinta. The platelets bind to each other via fibrin using a GP2B3A, which is a glycoprotein 2B3A receptor. This binds the platelets to each other. There actually are GP2B3A receptor blockers. These are abciximab, which is Riopro, tirofiban, which is Aggrastat, and eptifibatide, which is Integrilin. There's an inherited disease of GP2B3A receptor deficiency, which is Glanzmann's thrombocytopenia. And there's a GP1B receptor deficiency known as Bernard-Soulier disease. Platelets have a phosphodiesterase enzyme, which decreases cyclic AMP in the platelet. Dipyramidol is a phosphodiesterase inhibitor known as persantin. If you give a phosphodiesterase inhibitor, this increases cyclic AMP in the platelet, and this actually prevents platelet aggregation. Agranox is a combination of the dipyramidol phosphodiesterase inhibitor and aspirin. Let's talk a little bit about von Willebrand's disease. Von Willebrand disease is the most common bleeding disorder. About 1% of the population has it, and of those who have it, only about 1% are actually symptomatic. There are three types of von Willebrand disease. Type 1 is a low level of von Willebrand factor, and this could be treated with desmopressin, which is DDAVP. The second type of von Willebrand disease is an abnormal function of the von Willebrand factor, although they have normal levels. This is generally treated with DDAVP. The third type is the most serious type of von Willebrand disease, and that is where you do not have von Willebrand factor. That cannot be treated with a DDAVP. You have to use cryoprecipitate. The function of von Willebrand factor is to carry factor 8. To test for von Willebrand's disease, you can test for plasma von Willebrand factor antigen. There's a ristocetin test, and you can test directly for factor 8 activity. the ristocetin test seems to show up on the ABSITE most commonly. Okay, so moving on to talk about the actual coagulation cascade. So the coagulation cascade has two branches, the intrinsic branch and the extrinsic branch. The intrinsic branch starts off when vascular endothelial damage occurs, and then there's a cascade of factors with Roman numerals is traditionally how they're written, but starts off with 12, then it goes to 11, then it goes to 9, then it goes to 8, and then it comes back to 10, which is the common pathway. After 10, it goes to factor 5, and a lot of this process uses calcium. Factor 5 will convert prothrombin to thrombin. Thrombin is also known as factor 2. So, after thrombin is activated, it converts fibrinogen to fibrin. Fibrin is actually also known as factor 1. And the fibrin makes a fibrin plug, which cross-links using a factor 13. The extrinsic pathway starts with endothelial tissue damage that releases tissue factor known as factor 3. And this is a much shorter pathway and also much faster. It goes through factor 7 and then connects in at factor 10, which below 10 is considered the common pathway then. The way to remember which one PTT measures is I like to think of the sentence, he in a PTT meeting. He stands for heparin, in is intrinsic, PTT is the intrinsic pathway is measured with the PTT. WEPT is another way of remembering extrinsic pathway, WEPT. W stands for warfarin, E stands for the extrinsic pathway, and PT shows that the extrinsic pathway is measured with the PT. The vitamin K dependent factors include 2, which like we just learned is thrombin, as well as 7, 9, 10, and remember that protein C and S are also vitamin K dependent factors. The vitamin K dependent factors are inhibited by warfarin. You can reverse warfarin with vitamin K, which takes 6 hours, FFP, which takes 1 hour, and PCC, prothrombin complex concentrate, which is an immediate reversal. FFP contains all the coagulation factors. PCC contains 2, 7, 9, and 10. And cryoprecipitate includes von Willebrand's factor, factor 8, and fibrinogen. So cryoprecipitate is used in von Willebrand's disease and hemophilia A. Speaking of hemophilias, deficiency in factor 9 is actually hemophilia B. This is shown with an increase in PTT. It's inherited in a sex-linked recessive way. And prior to surgery, you need 100% factor 9 levels using recombinant factor 9. Deficiency in factor 8 is hemophilia A. That also causes an increase in PTT, also inherited as a sex-linked recessive trait. And you want to give recombinant factor 8 prior to surgery. Remember that factor 8 is actually made from the endothelium, whereas pretty much all of the other coagulation factors are made in the liver. Okay, let's talk about some medications. There are direct factor 10A inhibitors. The A stands for activated, but direct 10A inhibitors include rivaroxaban or Xarelto, apixaban or Eliquis, and endoxaban or Sevyasa. These direct 10A inhibitors are commonly used to treat DVT or PE and atrial fibrillation without valve disease, and sometimes use post knee or hip replacement. Remember that since calcium is important in the clotting cascade, citrate is used in stored blood and in test tubes to prevent blood clotting. There is also direct thrombin inhibitors. The direct thrombin inhibitors include leparudin, desirudin, bivalirudin or Angiomax, and argatroban or Acova. The direct thrombin inhibitors, especially argatroban, is commonly seen on tests as being used to treat HIT, or heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. The direct 10A inhibitors are given the nickname NOAC, which stands for novel oral anticoagulants. And interestingly, the direct 10A inhibitors and the direct thrombin inhibitors together are known as the DOACs, or direct oral anticoagulants. Remember that activated protein C and S are actually antithrombotic and inhibit factors 8 and 5 in the coagulation cascade. So when you give somebody Coumadin, you actually degrade the protein CNS faster, and this can lead to warfarin-induced skin necrosis. This is even more prominent in people that have an inherited protein C or S deficiency. Okay, so after the coagulation cascade happens, you've formed the fibrin plug, you have a nice clot, and then the vessels need to repair themselves, and repairing the tissues involves factors such as VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor. That's why bleeding and healing are not great on drugs like bevacizumab or Avastin, which is a VEGF inhibitor. And then after the clot has formed, eventually it needs to break down as the tissues heal, and that's the process of fibrinolysis. The endothelial cells secrete tissue plasminogen activator, or TPA, which is a drug we can actually give in patients that have had strokes. And the tissue plasminogen activator activates plasminogen to plasmin, and plasmin works to break fibrin down into fibrin split products. So fibrin split products go up after a lot of TPA, and one of the fibrin split products is actually D-dimer. So D-dimer levels go up after blood clotting as the clots are broken down. Specifically, the process of DIC, or disseminated intravascular coagulation, which happens in sepsis, causes low platelets, low fibrinogen levels, an increase in fibrin split products, an increase in D-dimer, and an increase in PT and PTT. Plasmin can be counteracted with the drug aminocaproic acid, or Amicar. A few random questions to finish up here. So post-cardiac stent, you need dual antiplatelet therapy for about 6 months. And another question is, when should you stop ADP receptor blockers such as clopidogrel or Plavix prior to surgery? You should stop them for about 5 days. Remember that direct platelet inhibitors like aspirin, you need to stop for 7 days or a full week, which is the half-life of platelets in the body. The other drugs, such as ticagrelor and Brilinta, which are ADP receptor blockers, but they only need to be stopped prior to surgery for 3 to 5 days. When should you stop NOACs or DOACs prior to surgery? If you have a low bleeding risk patient or a low bleeding risk surgery, 1 day prior is fine. If you have a high bleeding risk surgery, 2 days prior is fine. Remember that HIT, or heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, the decision to test for it using the test we described earlier is the four T's. So a thrombocytopenia with the fallen platelets greater than 50%. Timing, 5 to 10 days after initial exposure to the heparin. Thrombosis is the third T. This is classically a new DVT or arterial thrombosis, which can happen in HIT patients. And skin necrosis at the injection sites. And the last T is the T in other, which means you need to rule out other causes of low platelets such as drugs or DIC. Treatment for HIT is argatroban, which is a direct thrombin inhibitor, and obviously you need to stop the heparin. And lastly, remember that in pregnancy, you should generally use heparin, not Coumadin. And after a delivery, a baby that has an inherited clotting disorder can actually not bleed after a circumcision because the coagulation factors from the mother are still in the baby's blood. So that does not necessarily rule out a clotting disorder. Well, that's all I got on blood clotting. It's pretty dry stuff, but hopefully this will help you run through it quickly. as a refresher. And thanks for listening.